Myself, my name is Yannick Roy. I've been in the BCI field for a bit more than a decade. Co-founded Neurotech X 5 years ago. Neurotech X is an international neurotech community with different initiatives. The mission of the organization is to facilitate the advancement of neurotech. It's a very bold and ambitious mission. We do that by addressing three different pillars: community, education, and innovation. So the thesis is that if we connect people online through physical events of different sizes, some are more scientific, some are more hands-on, workshops, tutorials, lecture, conferences, hackathons, hack nights, small gathering, neurobars, all these kinds of things. If we connect people, we provide educational resources, knowledge, whether it's scientific or more business, more technical, once again. And then once people are connected, they have the knowledge, then they can go and have an impact on the field, whether it's by joining a company, starting one, tackling a challenge that remained unsolved, and all these things. So we see Neurotech X as being a funnel, a platform. We do have several initiatives. If you're interested in knowing more, neurotechx.com. So with no further ado, I would like to invite the speakers, the panelists, to open their camera, the microphone. We'll just go with a quick round of table of first introduction. The rule of engagement today, the idea is it's going to be free-flowing. It's a discussion. It's not a structured presentation. There is no slides, no PowerPoint. The idea here is to have a casual conversation, go a bit deeper on some scientific aspect, some of the neuroethics aspect, some on the more science fiction and where we're going with the future of the field and what it means for society. So it should be a fun ride. If you have any question, please mention that in the Q&A in the chat. We'll be monitoring that and we'll be asking our panelists all the questions that you have. It's a unique opportunity because we have very, very smart people that have been in the field for quite a while with different perspectives. So I think that's going to be a very interesting discussion. So I would like to maybe ask the panelists to their name, affiliation, background, the work that they their work in the field, and maybe one exciting project that they are currently working on at the moment. So, Dr. Jonathan Wolpa, do you mind starting off and kicking off this this round of presentation? You're muted at the moment.
Yes, I'm very happy to be here, and I'm thankful for the opportunity. I'm John Wolpa. I'm the director of the National Center for Adaptive Neurotechnologies, which is an NIH-funded center based at the Stratton VA Hospital, Veterans Administration Hospital in Albany. It also has two other sites, Medical University of South Carolina in Charleston and Washington University in St. Louis, where major parts of the center take place, the work of the center. So I'm a neurologist by training a long time ago, so I'm sort of a 1980s era neurologist. I've since, for the last 40 years, been doing basic and clinical research in animals and humans in neuroscience, very much interested initially in plasticity, specifically the basis of learning and memory. And for that reason, and a little unexpectedly at the time, I started studying plasticity in the spinal cord. And that's developed very well. It worked out very well. Somewhat later, my interest in BCI was piqued by an inquiry from actually IBM Corporation, and I put it together with some old EEG studies I'd done, and that developed, and it developed as separate fields for quite a while, and then the BCI field, obviously, as people know, exploded starting in the 1990s, and it's developed from there. I've been very struck by the fact that my two interests have come together pretty much inextricably now, and they're really basically the same interest. So I'm really excited about the prospects of the field. I think you have a fair perspective on it as it's developed over the years, and I'm happy to be here.
Awesome. Thank you, Dr. Wolpa. Karen, do you wanna go next?
Sure. Thanks for having me here. I was thrilled to be invited to this. And of course, I can't say no to Yanni because we have a old friendship where we work together a lot on neurotech and ethics. So I'm excited to be here with you all. I'm a neurotech ethicist. I'm trained in neuroscience and in ethics, and I work at value conflicts related to emerging tech. I direct the neuroethics program at Emory University at the Center for Ethics, where I also hold faculty appointments in the Department of Neurology and Psychiatry in the School of Medicine. I specialize in cross-cultural perspectives on the brain and the mind, and much of my work is with an organization called the International Brain Initiative, which is a consortium of 7 large-scale national-level brain research projects. And with them, I co-chair the Neuroethics Working Group that helps to implement neuroethics strategy and innovation into those projects. I also am a neurotech ethics consultant and strategist, and I work with neuroinnovators to understand their ethics roadblocks and work with them to co-create tools to overcome them. And I do this with transnational government organizations like the OECD, local governments like organizations like the NIH. And these days I devise ways to facilitate cross-sectoral collaborations with the private sector in neuroethics and innovation.
Awesome. Thank you very much for being in the panel. Definitely that angle, especially. We'll talk about that more during the panel. So I'll hand over to Mikhail Lebedev, or Misha.
Hello, my name is Mikhail Lebedev, and I am currently a scientific director at the Center of Bioelectrical Interfaces at the Higher School of Economics, Moscow, Russia. So I have a mega grant from the government of Russian Federation for facilitating the development of brain-machine interfaces in Russia. So this is going very well. Before that, I started my scientific career in motor control in humans. Then I shifted to monkey neurophysiology, then to invasive brain machine interfaces in monkeys. So, and hopefully I will also restart this work in Russia, like invasive animal research in monkeys. So, And also, since we are talking about Neuralink now, I know some people who work at Neuralink, and I worked with them before.
Perfect. So, as you can see, we do have a lot of experience on the panel. But before we dive into the meat of the panel discussion, let's start with an easy question, because we're obviously talking about Neuralink and Elon Musk. He tends to project us in the future, sometime in a far future that might be coming soon. So quick question for the panel. Working in a futuristic field, do you watch or read or consume science fiction? And if so, do you have any recommendation for the sci-fi out there? Could be brain, obviously, if it's brain related, even the better. But any good recommendation for science fiction fan out there? Volpa, do you want to, or Mikhail?
I used to do this when I was a kid. So I read some science fiction. So I know what it is about, but right now I do not read because I simply do not have time. And this may be a little bit boring compared to the work we do.
Yes, I agree. I read science fiction a good deal as a kid, but right now for me, science is much more fun than science fiction. So I've seen some of the recent movie with Matthew McConaughey, which was, I mainly liked for the adventures part of it. Though I gather the science is fairly realistic and they had good advisors. But basically real science for me is much more exciting than science fiction at this point.
I think those answers are kind of cheating, but okay. Those are good. Actually, those are really good answers. I also feel like I don't have time really to read a lot of things I'd like to read for fun. But I read a lot of fantasy when I was younger. And actually I used to watch things like Black Mirror, but then it made me think too much before I went to bed. And so I couldn't sleep, so I had to stop. But what we did was actually do an analysis for our neuroethics program. And some of our students did a neuroethics analysis of all these Black Mirror episodes. And we published that in a little book. So let me know if you're interested in that. And you can also find it on www.theneuroethicsblog.com.
Yeah, I should also say in response to Karen's comment that, I mean, the little I've seen and heard sort of indirectly or even directly about science fiction, it's really very frustrating because it's either very unrealistic or very naive or just plain wrong or just basically dull. So it's kind of frustrating to read it and look at, you know, contrast it with the reality. And the reality is basically a lot more exciting, a lot more innovative, at least in the in a field that I don't know much about, I might be able to enjoy it. But in this field, I definitely don't enjoy it.
You're being
told. I watched the movie Avatar, though. This one I watched. Yeah.
Yes, me too.
So you're being too critical of this the science fiction. So sci-fi authors should reach out to you guys to make sure that they are a bit more grounded in reality and science. Awesome. Thank you very much for that. So let's start with a bit of a recap, a fast track. So Mikhail, you've been writing a lot of reviews and kind of like the last years in the evolution of the field. Do you mind starting with kind of like a bit of a fast track, nothing super structured, but just for you, what is the like the last, not necessarily 100 years, but 50 years, let's say something like that. What's the evolution that led us to neural implants that we have today that we're starting to talk about implanting in people and automated surgery for consumer, let's say, not just the medical, that we're starting to talk about that. So do you mind just giving us the three minutes fast track history?
Yeah, sure. I can even try to share my screen. One second, I will see if I can do this. Okay. So I will skip through this. I'll skip through this in Elon Musk thing. So probably describing the whole history would be longer than 2 minutes, but I would like to attract your attention to something that you may not know well about, that in the late 60s and in the 70s in the Soviet Union, there was work on brain-machine interfaces, and Viktor Gurfinkel published a book on bioelectrical control, where if you read this book, it is unfortunately in Russian, but it describes bioelectrical systems that are controlled by EMG activity or heart muscle activity, or maybe by electrical activity of the brain. So like if you look inside the book, then you see this, the first Soviet myoelectrical prosthesis of the hand, and you can see that it is being tested in a very important role. So probably at NeuroBar, we can talk about this more. I'll just mention some systems that they describe. So for example, they describe this bioelectrical control of the ventilator for the lungs. So here, EMG activity is registered from intercostal muscles. And then this is the signal to control this ventilator. Also, they thought about the control of the delivery of the anesthetic like pharmacological agents that control the level of anesthesia. So here they record activity of the brain, and this gives you an objective measure of like the depth of anesthesia. They also thought about these controlling the movement of the electrodes when you want to record from the brain. And so many ideas were there. So yes, I will stop sharing. So, but also, of course, there were some experiments in the 60s on bioelectrical feedback, neurofeedback. Camille and Sherman, they did EEG recordings, and They had trained epileptic patients to suppress the epileptic activity. Then in 1963, Gray Walter had a very good demonstration where he connected the motor cortex of his patients to a slide project and they moved the slides. He didn't call it a brain-machine interface, but it was basically brain-machine interface. Then non-invasive interfaces, we had developments from, I think Jack Vidal was the first to introduce this idea of a brain-computer interface, and his interface was mostly based on visual evoked potentials. Then on the invasive fronts, there were demonstrations by Miguel Nicolelis, Andy Schwartz, then John Donahue. They competed a lot, and because of this competition, very quickly some demonstrations were made in rhesus macaques. They recorded ensembles of cortical cells. And like among these demonstrations of a monkey controlling a robotic arm that can reach and grasp, then interface for locomotion, and also a sensorized interface where a monkey reaches with a virtual hand and it receives artificial tactile sensations that are formed by electrical stimulation of the somatosensory cortex. So this is my part, and I'm sure Jonathan and Karen can add more to this.
Yes, that was a pretty comprehensive review. I mean, there weren't many things that you left out in that short a time. There are a couple of things. The first thing it made me think about when you were talking, actually, when you mentioned Victor Gerfinkel, I remembered seeing him, he spoke at Ed Everett's lab when I was there in the 1970s. So I'm sorry, I hadn't realized that he died recently.
Just recently.
Yeah, I remembered he was obviously quite old. And I remember seeing him then. But there are a couple of things. You also reminded me of the experiments that I read about actually as a kid in Russia, where there were two heads on one dog.
Mm-hmm.
I always wondered about that, and I never learned, obviously it was just in the news, but it was pretty striking at the time. But talking about one thing that you didn't mention in terms of the single neuron recording, it was really begun by Eb Fetz in the 1960s, the late 60s. He far preceded the other people you mentioned who did significant stuff, but he really started it. And he's really still in the field and has contributed till very recently. The idea that you could control something with a single neuron and motor cortex. So that's important, I think. So anyway, but you did, it was a pretty comprehensive job. So.
Thanks. Thanks for the review. So you mentioned the monkeys, for example, where it's been demonstrated they've had implants before, reach and grasp, kind of like BCI paradigms kind of thing. What we've seen with the Neuralink demo with the pig, the images that you have behind you, I don't know if it's related or unrelated, the,
yes.
The pig. Maybe these are the early drawing of the experiment. I don't know. What is different? What is different from what we've seen with the pigs and what we've seen with monkeys from an experiment standpoint, not necessarily the tech? And the second question will be about more of the tech of what's new. But in terms of the experiment, was this something new or not?
So let me. I will share my screen once again. One second.
You definitely can prepare to the panel.
So yeah, I have some. Oh, one second. No, it wouldn't. I have been making this joke. One second. Yeah, I have been making this joke about Elon Musk that he repeats after me. For example, he published this paper, but if you compare the wording of this paper with the wording from my paper, this is pretty similar. So this is a joke. So So Elon's Musk demonstration is pretty impressive. They use these electrodes where they have a bunch of recording spots. So electrodes are pretty good. The way to put them in the brain is great. Actually, Tim Henson, whom I worked with, invented this sewing machine for the brain. So they put this little microwires inside the brain. So with the robot, and they have the right electronics, and it works really well. So like if you look at the recording quality, it is typical. So I would call this a mixture of units and multi-units. And what else? Since we're here, I will show you this video that we did maybe 7 years ago. So you can see here is a monkey. We are recording close to 600 neurons and very good spikes, lots of spikes. And the monkey can control the movements of this virtual arm. So in terms of what they demonstrated, this is very similar to what we had before and the other groups had before. But what is impressive is that they have this fully implanted device. So like no wires are sticking from the head. So no like monkey cap or in their case, the pig cap. Everything is small and good. I would say this is a very remarkable methodological development. So not so much in terms of neurophysiology, but as methodology, this is a great step forward.
Awesome. John, you're muted if you're...
Microphone.
You're still muted, John.
The engineering is very impressive. That there's no question about that, and it's exciting. The science is very conventional. There's nothing new. The kinds of things they're showing have been done for decades. And as Mikhail was showing, have gone well beyond what they show there in the demonstration. So it's. In reading for this panel, I read some more about them, and I'd had an impression, but I hadn't known much before, and it pretty much confirmed the impression that they're really good engineers. They have a lot of there's obviously a lot of money, a lot of power behind this, and the engineering is very exciting. The device they're building will be very useful for scientists to use, and maybe eventually for clinicians. But in terms of the actual science, the kinds of things they're seeing that they're projecting, the more futuristic things that Elon Musk is talking about, those are going to require a lot of science. And the major problems with that are not technology, they're science at this point. But the device they're making could be very useful to scientists to gain this knowledge, to gain this understanding. So if I were involved in directly in those kinds of things, I'd be very excited about getting one of these implants. And in the future, I'll be happy about collaborating with people using them. But the science and the concept of how the nervous system works that comes across in the presentations is at best conventional, and really in many ways very simplistic and limited. But the engineering is really stellar and will produce something good, I think, if they keep at it.
Can I say something about this? I don't have anything to add about the technical versus the science, because I think that's very clear and technically it's very fascinating. The science isn't up to where it needs to be, and it's really relatively unimpressive in that way. But what people are really drawn to, there's some people, maybe a lot of people here who are drawn to the technology, but most of the people I think are entering into this conversation because of this cult of personality around Elon Musk. You know, he ends up being, although I think the scientists that he brings on stage and to speak are very reasonable and practical, I think Elon Musk tends to, and actually Elon Musk has a lot of qualified statements. I don't know if somebody's been coaching him because he says, you know, in the future, we'll be able to do this. We're not able to do this right now. He says that a lot, actually, to his credit. And he also says, somebody coached him about mind control fears, because he also says this is going to be an elective surgery if anybody wants it eventually, an elective option. But really, he simultaneously plays into that theater. So his vision ends up getting pushed for this, this fear around AI. And I think what's really great about him, and I want to impress upon this, is that we do need people with a grand vision. And a lot of times scientists, we're so used to 99% of our results not working in the lab that you kind of get to be a pessimist, and that's kind of how the scientific method even works. So it's good to have people who I think Max Hodak, his lead scientist, said, you know, push on the imagined constraints that scientists have. That's great. But, and especially if that's towards a good, like I think Elon Musk is suggesting, and I think a lot of the scientists who are working with him are probably driven by this too, some kind of public good, alleviating suffering, helping restore movement in people who are paralyzed. And I think one of the Q&As, somebody said, do you think they'll fulfill that promise? I don't know, but I think that is definitely their first step into this. But his grander vision of what's driving him to fund all of this is really one not around benefiting humanity and reducing suffering in that way. I think it more betrays kind of an individual fear about the fragility of power that comes with being someone in a position like Elon Musk. So I think that's something to keep in mind with a lot of this framing. There's kind of a needs to be, in some ways, to understand and really appreciate technology, you have to separate, find ways to parse out where some of this is part of a kind of a grand theatrical act and where part of the science is and where it's practically trying to go, and not undermine some of the good that's happening out of the science because of the theater and showmanship that Elon Musk is putting out there. And he's not really a good showman, actually, in some ways. He's a terrible speaker. I don't know if somebody needs to coach him on that, too. But I guess when you have a lot of money, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, I sort of agree. I mean, I agree, I guess, with a lot of what Karen was saying. I'd never heard him speak before. And, you know, I found him impressive in that he seemed likable and he seemed very tentative and very appropriate and clearly not a good speaker. But he seemed like a thoughtful, engaged, sophisticated person I was more impressed than I thought I would be. I don't really see him as having some personal fear about this or loss of power. The grand vision is, I mean, it's nice to see, and the grand vision part of it, he may provide the technology that enables others to begin to understand what may get to the grand vision. And a lot of the things he's saying about AI and the competition with AI doesn't make a lot of sense when you think about it. What he's doing is, you know, when he talks about where he sees the future going, he's not so much competing with AI as he's turning people into AI, or, you know, at least making some sort of cyborg out of people, which is, they're not going to be the same afterwards. They may be better, but they're not going to be the same. And that's where I think the most interesting neuroethical issues come into this. They're not really solvable. I don't see them solvable at this point, but they're important. And, it's very impressive, and it's very impressive engineering. The science is not very exciting. I mean, it's very conventional and simplistic, but the engineering's really neat.
Yeah. I appreciate your response to that. And, you know, what I do is I study a lot of people's underlying assumptions and unspoken assumptions. So I kind of dig into that a lot and to that analysis. And one of the things that, and Elon Musk's discussion about AI and love of the idea of enhancement is really not uncommon. It's pretty much a shared belief amongst a lot of certain sector of people. But you know, Jonathan, he's very practical in that he talks about, and I think Yannick mentioned this tertiary layer that he proposes, that there's this tertiary layer that the technology is going to produce, and it's going to provide some kind of symbiosis with Neuralink. But he also rightly mentions that, you know, we already kind of have that. You know, we do that with our phones, we do that with our computers, so why worry about this? But on the other hand, you know, he says that, and then the conflicting message that comes across is that a very practical one, and then he talks about this existential threat. This is a term that's overused a lot right now. And it's this threat about AI that can be solved with a scientific answer. And, you know, but really worrying about new technology and how it's going to change life. And it's often, from if you study history and culture, is really one of the most defining features of being human. We always worry about the next technology. Not to say that there aren't some worries that need to be there, because that's why I have a job. But, you know, with Gutenberg's printing press, oh my gosh, people were so worried about how lazy the public were gonna become with this memory prosthetic, and they wouldn't have good memories anymore, when actually it really democratized knowledge and information. And allowed the public, a broader public, to be educated, and allowed for a lot of knowledge sharing across geographic boundaries. But now we're worried that AI is gonna lead to the extinction of humans and some unrecoverable global catastrophe due to some super entity that makes humans not at the top of the food chain. And that is the stuff of science fiction that probably makes a lot of us not wanna read it anymore. But, you know, we don't need to turn to, if you really want to look for a dramatic existential threat, you don't need to turn further than climate change or global warming or even the global pandemic that we're in. But this term existential is called upon and abused to generate reaction and gravity. And that is something clever that I think that a lot of speakers do, and maybe unintentionally if I'm trying to be generous, but I think Elon Musk uses it well with part of his performance, that, you know, this existential term and threat is used kind of as a shibboleth, and it signals some kind of educated discernment of with some philosophical thought that leads to some sort of authority of being able to make an issue have more gravity or dread and summon a kind of fearful reactivity. And in that has become a really dominant thing around this neurotechnology and many other of the narratives that are in the public eye. And so I think that speakers like Musk or others, anybody who's talking to the public, has to think carefully about when they're thinking about the full impact and trying to sell their technology, how these words are all playing together and tapping into the imaginations.
Yeah, I certainly agree with the overuse of existential threats. I mean, it's basically a simplistic sort of non-specific kind of, you know, wake up call kind of. But I mean, this is different. The thing about, you know, you mentioned technology that we've always had, which is correct. But all the technologies that we've developed up to the moment work with the nervous system as it's evolved. And their interactions with the nervous system go through the normal input-output pathways. Now, drugs are aside, that's another issue. But we really have now two kinds of scientific advances which are new. I'm not saying they're bad or good or they're threatening or they're non-threatening, they're new. One are the genetic advances that we can actually go in and play with the genes and we can change things. And Matt, that's a huge area, but equally the fact that the nervous system is not dictated by genetics, it's continually adjusting based on its inputs and outputs. And as it has evolved, it has very evolved inputs and outputs, input, afferent nerves, efferent nerves, et cetera, hormones. That's it, that's what it works with. That's the interaction that it has with the outside world and with the body. Now, this is something new. We're going into it and working in its midst and basically imitating it interfacing with it very intimately in ways that it wasn't designed to deal with, in ways that are going to change it in ways that we can't really predict at this point. Now, it's reassuring that we're very crude at this point. We don't really have really good interfaces, either technically or scientifically, so we can't do a whole lot, but that'll get better. But that kind of interaction, what that's going to do, I don't know if it's a threat or a blessing. It's probably both, but it's going to change people in ways that haven't happened before. And it's going to do things that raise huge issues that, I mean, I certainly don't have an answer to. I don't even have a real grasp of what they are and how we go about responding to them. And these are, I think, are the core neuroethical threats, neuroethical issues, not so much threats, but neuroethical concerns that we need to have. We need to have. There are new things. This is something new under the sun. It needs to be recognized and addressed that way. And the fact that it's coming slowly is good, because we'll have some time to do that. But this is something new. It's not just, you know, an iPhone. Because iPhones, you use, you know, your normal senses and your muscles are how you interface with an iPhone.
Well, to be clear, don't get me wrong. I have a job in this space because there are new ethics questions that are come up with neuroscience. And I've seen firsthand, working on deep brain stimulation, I've seen firsthand what that can do. So it's not that I don't think that there's dramatic impact and that these are impressive, unprecedented technologies. That's not what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is that there are near-term concerns, intermediate concerns, and far-term concerns that even are phantom concerns. And there are plenty of near-term reasonable concerns to worry about before jumping to the existential dread of us becoming one with AI. That's more of a fantastical question, but you're right. You know why we can't address that now? Because we're not even close to that. Because what we do in neuroethics is I actually use my scientific background and philosophical training to use evidence-based science to inform the types of philosophical questions I'm asking. So, you know, I'm thinking more about, and we can talk about this later, you know, but I'm thinking more about privacy and agency. I am thinking to some extent about what you're talking about. I'm thinking about societal issues. We're thinking about how these change norms, those aren't answered either. And I don't think it's the job. I don't think it's the job, Jonathan, of philosophy for neuroethics to only address questions that seem looking at the head of a pin.
You're dismissing the futuristic questions. They're not so futuristic. There are things we can do now that we are doing now with deep brain stimulation, for example, which may get into some of these things. We could create problems that we don't know about. You know, when you
dismissing that, John.
We could be changing the brain in ways that we don't know about. I mean, it's a basic tenet of therapy that, you know, when you have a therapy, there's the effect you know about and the effect you don't know about.
Yeah, Jonathan, I appreciate what you're saying.
Could be doing harmful things right now.
Absolutely. And that's what I think we're on the same page, Jonathan. I hold those in a different space than the existential threat of an AI overlord. But
no,
maybe we differ on that.
About AI. AI to me is kind of, as you say, a shibboleth, and I'm not even sure what it means or how it relates. It's a kind of a catch term that people like at this point. That's not my concern, that it is an existential threat. It's the very specific things in the therapies that we're engaging in now. And for me, you're right. They're questions that are very important that may be more easily addressed. And things like privacy, et cetera, are important. I'm not saying they aren't, but these issues are there too. And from my point of view, really as a scientist, they're very interesting questions.
These issues being ones around agency and autonomy and identity. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes, basically. Are we changing? Are we going to change what people do, what people want, what people are? In ways that we can't foresee, by stimulating in various areas or by recording from certain areas and providing feedback on that basis. We'll be doing things that I mean, at this point, what we do is pretty trivial, it seems. But yeah. In principle, we could do things that we could do bad things. I mean, I have faith in the system that it's very robust, that it will be able to handle what we do. But that isn't certain. And we're certainly going to be doing things that we can't necessarily predict ahead of time. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to be watching for these things. I don't think this is going to happen tomorrow, and I don't think something terrible is going to happen tomorrow. But it's something that needs to be watched for.
I definitely agree. I think that this was a very, very interesting point of view in the conversation. Thank you very much for that. Going back to, so we do have Xing who just joined us. I think that there was a time zone misunderstanding. That's the live international mistake that can happen out of that. Unfortunately, we didn't have Xing for the first part. I just want to, well, I'll let Xing maybe introduce herself quickly, and then I want to continue, not exactly on that, but Elon Musk, kind of, as you mentioned, seems to have been coached or using some wordings. Sometimes, yes, it seems a bit more coached, and sometimes it's a bit more raw. When, for example, Joe Rogan, he's been on the podcast talking about telepathic communication in like 5 years, 10 years, I think at most. Neuroscientists would disagree with that claim, but I want to go, and there is the Elon Musk thesis about making the brain digital. So there is the AI aspect, but I want to just shift towards from AI to making the brain digital and just having your thoughts once Xing introduced herself about this idea of digitalizing the brain. So all this mind uploading. So I want to ask yourself, and Xing, maybe you can take the first stab at it. Do you think that the brain is a finite model that we can digitalize and understand, and that we can at some point manipulate memories, for example? So can we store, upload, change memories, or is there something else in the brain that we just, with science and tech, we just can't understand and grasp? So anything with mind uploading and these kinds of things, we just can't digitalize the brain. So obviously, we all agree that's a very complex model. I'm not saying that we're any place near of mapping, understanding this system, but can we, with the best, all the money in the world, all the best tech, all the best science, can we digitalize the brain or not really? So Xing, floor is yours if you want to introduce and take a first stab at the question.
So hi, everyone. Sorry that I was late. Thanks a lot for having me. I'm Xing, and I work at the Netherlands Institute for Neuroscience, which is one of the institutes in Amsterdam, part of the KNAV. And my specialty is in visual prostheses. So the last 6 years, I've been a postdoc working together with Peter Rufsema, and we've developed a brain implant that we test in animals. And our overarching goal is to create a device that will allow blind people to regain a rudimentary form of vision in the future. So we work together with a team of people on different aspects, including the hardest part, that's the implants, and also the AI and the rest of the system. And so that's my introduction. To go into, to take a stab at what Yannick was talking about, let's skip the preamble about how difficult it would be to simulate the brain. I think that to some degree, there has been some success. There's been a lot of attempts to try and digitize parts of the brain. So people really try to tackle the problem in smaller pieces. So for example, creating models of just individual columns in the visual cortex, for example, or trying to simulate all the processes that take place within a neuron or a small group of neurons. I think that to some degree, if you have access to experimentally driven data and you can ground your theories and your models in actual data, then we can actually come up with meaningful theories and hypotheses and test them. However, it all needs to be designed very rigorously. And the main thing is that we need to identify where we're making these assumptions, check whether they're based in truth, see if we can predict what's going to happen in a scientific manner, and then see if we can back that up with data. So that's just to begin with, in theory, if we were able to rally all the computational resources that were required to model the brain, I think that it could be possible. However, there's so many assumptions going into that. There's whose brain are you going to model? You know, all our brains are different. At what level are you going to model them? And what's the eventual goal of modeling a particular brain? Is it to answer neuroscientific questions? Is it so that we can reduce the use of animals in research? So it's a very broad topic. I think it's an interesting goal to have, but the main question is, why do we want to achieve this in the first place?
Mikhail, do you wanna?
So I found it interesting that Elon Musk used the pigs for their demonstration. They probably did it to avoid animal rights activists. However, somewhere I read complaints from animal rights activists that said that you are invading these pigs' privacy, so it didn't give consent for this implant. So even for the pigs, they complained. But I also looked what pigs have in terms of the brain. And it was very interesting. It appears that pretty much the whole brain of the pig represents the snout. They do have a prefrontal cortex, so they think. And in terms of motor cortex, remember they showed this video of a pig walking on a treadmill. Assuming that they recorded from the motor cortex, it's a little bit hard to record from there because it is located very medially in the pig brain, so you have to go like deep in the brain. So, but the pigs are interesting. Like, if you think like, what can you do from these pigs? Like, make super pigs or something like. Upload the pig's brain content to a computer or what? So, like the first thing that comes to mind, to my mind at least, is to use somehow their remarkable snout and their ability to smell and to explore their space with the snout. The other thing is that they're great locomotion animals. And they are perfectly fitted for this spinal cord implant, spinal cord stimulating implant. And right now there is work ongoing where they stimulate spinal cord and restore locomotion ability. And there was a demo from Cortine group where they had this walking monkey, but maybe a pig would be even a better object. So I'm basically trying to think realistically because we can talk about this mind upload or memory upload or like we will implant the brain and cure all possible diseases. But now the question is realistic, like where we go from there and what can be done. So like talking specifically about pigs, there are many interesting demonstrations that could be done. For example, of course, they would again repeat after Cortine, but an interface that takes brain activity and stimulates the spinal cord and somehow controls locomotion. So this would be an interesting implication. So
it's interesting. Your question really brings up a couple of things. That first, that you know, you talk about digitizing the brain. That I mean, it's really it's an old saying in neuroscience that every generation or really every age thinks about the brain in terms of their highest technology. So the Greeks talk about the brain as writing on a wax tablet. In the in the 17th century, they talked about the brain, and Descartes talked about it in terms of hydraulics. In the 18th century, they talked about it in Newtonian sense in terms of oscillations. And we talk about it in terms of computers. And our doing that is not necessarily any better or any closer to the reality than what was done previously. So that's something to keep in mind. very much that that can that's we may be very much distorted by that. The other our thinking. The other thing to realize is that neuroscience, unique among scientists, has a tremendous disadvantage, and has had it from the beginning. That we think because we think we know what's going on inside because we have awareness of what we think is going on inside. So we think we know there are things like memories and there are things like actions and there are things like emotions and there are things like reasons. We think this, and that's all very effective in real life, but it basically has very little to do with what's going on inside, probably. And it's very misleading to try to address the brain and to try to understand the brain using these concepts. I mean, memories as we conceive of them simply don't exist, probably. There aren't things written down in the brain. The brain produces behaviors. That's what it does. It doesn't write things down that you could then look at and record and transfer to somebody else's brain, et cetera. So, I mean, the very issues that the kinds of words we apply, we're very much distorted by the fact that we know what's going on in there, or we have some understanding of it, and we basically have very little. We have to address this the same way we address other kinds of scientific problems. We have to really act like if we were highly intelligent robots coming down to Earth and watching people walk around and having no idea that they were conscious or what they thought about themselves, and just looking at their behavior and trying to figure out what's going on inside. We would come up with something very different from our current understanding of memories and emotions and things like that. We would have a very different understanding, and it would be really closer to the reality.
So. Yeah, I love that. And I think that really well, outlined kind of how I love that statement about, and I've heard it invoked before, just we always have our highest technology is something tied back to the brain. And I was thinking about what Dr. Chen was saying about, a very important question, actually a fundamental one that I often ask innovators is, why are you doing this? What is your true motivation and goal? And sometimes people can't even articulate that, which is often surprising. I mean, another surprising thing is most scientists can't define research, which is because I teach research, research ethics. Anyway, that's a whole other thing. but, the cultural meaning assigned to scientific finding is really important. And I think that what Jonathan was getting at that too, we're talking about, Musk is talking about mind uploading, kind of, avoiding this meat sack of a body and, moving on into something at a higher level that is just infinite and immortal. But if we look at the flip side and think about death, we really don't even know what the moment of death. People don't, and actually that would differ culturally, but the practical ways that we define that someone is dead aren't even consistent. So we have this brain death criteria that's supposed to be sort of universal. It's not really, it's not universally implemented across the US where I am. It's not actually adopted across the world. And some have even called it a legal fiction, where we've designated this death because it's also lent to a lot of helpful things like being able to have better organs that are in better shape to donate. But when we say someone is dead in the US and we say that they're brain dead, assuming there's some kind of consistency, which there's not as much as we'd like, it's just that we've decided that whatever activity that is low enough so that it's not meaningful anymore. There's no meaningful connections with the world or with other people. That is not a scientific thing as much as that's a societal value statement. So I think that's something to keep in mind. And the same is going to be true. This is like what Jonathan was saying about memories and how we conceive of memories. Another important point that I hope people take away from this is that, and again, it's related to what Dr. Chen said, why are you doing this? And even what question are you trying to solve? So when people say, oh, we're gonna understand the brain, we're gonna understand the nature of being human. I mean, I agree that there are great insights from neuroscience. This is why I'm in neuroscience, that relate to aspects of being human that are more powerful in some ways than anything else. But the scientific method is not a religion. It's but one method that we use to understand the world. And it's a tool that has certain parameters and abilities. And it's not one, it derives from scientia, which means being knowledge based on demonstrable and reproducible data, right? And also a tenet of the scientific method is that a hypothesis is testable and falsifiable, right? So now start thinking about entering questions about the nature of the mind, which actually, when we talk about brain uploading, people interchangeably and sloppily use mind uploading. I mean, this is something that maybe as we enter into, you know, even the same with along Jonathan's lines of memory, consciousness, I think we'll agree. Consciousness is a totally loaded term. If you ask someone who studies consciousness what they're doing, they've kind of tried to operationalize and break down consciousness. But I don't think any good researcher in that space would tell you they fully understand and can recreate consciousness and understand what that is. Same with thoughts, right? No scientist will honestly be able to tell you that they understand what exactly a thought is in the brain. This is also what Jonathan was alluding to with memories. And I think we need to be realistic about what science can offer so that we don't get disappointed by science as well and can really fully understand its impact.
Yeah, I completely agree with what Karen's saying, that science is a method that has rules. And for example, she brought up consciousness. Consciousness is at this point is not a scientific problem. It's just not a scientific problem because it doesn't have a measure. It can't be measured. We have words like arousal. We have words like attention. We have words like perception. We can define those words. We can measure those words. Consciousness, we can't measure. It's not a scientific issue. It's like saying, well, we're going to determine what beauty is, or we're going to determine what truth is, or we're going to determine what good is and evil is, and we're going to use a scientific method. It's something that is not, we can't measure it. There's not something to measure, and there is nothing that demands we have the word consciousness. You're not allowed in science to just develop a term and say, well, I'm studying this. You have to have a reason for the term. You have to have a phenomenon that the term applies to, that you can measure. And we don't have that. And so like all the attention now, scientifically, that consciousness gets makes no sense to me whatsoever. I think it's basically a backwater. And to the extent that it's gonna do anything good, they'll be looking at things like, not a backwater, it's a dead end. Things like arousal or things like perception or attention, those things, which I think Karen was alluding to, what people break out and say they're studying consciousness. They're not studying consciousness. They're studying those things. And it really, scientifically, it goes back to when they talked about, in the 19th century, the luminiferous ether, which was supposedly the substance in which light traveled. And everyone knew it existed. But then with the Michelson-Morley experiment, it became clear that it didn't appear to exist. And that led to the theory of relativity. That was part of the background to it. This thing that everyone assumed existed just went away because it wasn't measurable. There wasn't anything there to detect. And I think it's similar. It's frustrating from our point of view to think that we can't necessarily address this, but that's the reality of science. It is a method, as Karen was saying, and it has limitations and it has rules that you have to follow.
Very, very interesting. Speaking
about the transition to death, there was a paper, I think, 2 years ago published in Nature where they revived the dead pig's brain, by the way, speaking of pigs. So I think they probably just put some chemicals and oxygenated it and so it was not decomposing so rapidly. But there was a lot of press about this, like, oh, you revived the pig's brain. So I think they even had to rewrite their protocol so just to make sure that all ethical issues were addressed. So this, speaking about consciousness, I am also kind of a little bit skeptical of all these theories of consciousness. Some of them are more reasonable, some are pretty crazy. Roger Penrose got a Nobel Prize a few days ago, but his theory of consciousness is more crazy than realistic. But speaking of realistic theories like integrated information theory, you can actually measure this. And in this part, brain-computer interfaces could help understand the consciousness, or at least advanced a little bit in these studies. Because first of all, you can enter different areas of the brain that are presumed to do something with the consciousness, and then you read information from there, and then evaluate it and quantify it. Also, you could stimulate different parts of the brain and then see what effect it has on consciousness. Moreover, if you have this brain-computer interface that presumably interferes with your consciousness, you also have your own subjective feelings or what you feel, your qualia, etc. So it gives you a unique opportunity to experiment with your own consciousness. So you can, like, if I look at some animal or human subject and try to guess what's going on in his consciousness, it is hard. But if I am doing this on myself and just see what happens, this may also help.
Very good.
Can I just say, because yep. I was involved with the early kind of consultations on Ninad Sestan's work and the restoration of activity in pig brains, I want to say that that was an example of actually the researchers were very attuned to the ethical issues and were very concerned, and they had already developed a protocol before we even got there. Before they even called upon us to be very careful and thoughtful about what they were doing. I think one of the lingering, and we worked actually carefully with the National Institutes of Health team to try to steer the public conversation on that in a healthy way, one that didn't go off the rails and was like, oh my gosh. I think NIH thought it was mostly a success. There were only a few really totally out there. High profile pieces, but that was something, you know, where there was a nice, I think there were a lot of lessons learned there from the researchers and the communications team and ethicists kind of talking together about what is the message we want to make sure comes out really clearly, and what do we know people already assume about this to be true, and we had to address a lot of that. So I feel like I had to say something about that because I was involved in it.
Awesome. I see that time is flying by. I do have a lot of questions. You've been generous with your answers, making my job as moderator very easy. I don't actually have to go through my questions. You're just giving us so much insight. But I also want to include the audience who's here with us live on Zoom today. Karen, you talked about the social impact and the aspect of like the culture. I would be interested in knowing the opinion of the crowd here, and we do have a poll, so if the organizer can send the poll. The question is basically, if you could improve your memory 10 times or tenfold with a brain implant, it's free, it's safe, it's been done 1,000 times, it's totally safe, it's free, it just works. Would you have the brain implant? The question is, would you enhance yourself, your memory, with a brain implant? Yes or no? And obviously, there are so many more layers to that question, but let's keep it as simple as that for now.
Well, I wouldn't know. I mean, I'd have to ask what they mean by improve. I mean, I really have no idea exactly. Do you remember things that, and is this something that you can then, that you can enumerate? You know, you can remember 50 numbers or 70 numbers instead of the normal 7 in a row.
Jonathan, if you got the brain implant, you would know the answer to that question.
Yes,
already.
Probably. Probably. Right. I need to
The best framework is that you control your memory. You just have 10 times more of what you want to control and how you want to control it.
It could be overwhelming. It could basically be incapacitating. No.
It's often remarkable. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Mikhail.
Very briefly, there is some history to this question. Actually, in medieval times, it was considered non-ethical to try to write something down. Just you had, this was considered cheating. So if you wanted to remember something, you had to memorize. Now, nobody has to memorize anything because you just take your cell phone and get any information you need. So with the implants, I think this just gives you a tool to connect to some other device that keeps memory. So Ian, the big question is, why do I need to connect directly from the brain if I can use just my normal ways to communicate? So like if scientists or us or Elon Musk manages to improve these communications, then this would make some difference.
Awesome. So we'll wait for a few more answers. Yep. Thanks.
No, I don't want to delay the poll questions. I'm interested to see what's next.
So we'll leave a few more seconds for the people to, and then the organizer can just give us the answers. I will go, okay. So yes, 66%, no, 33%. So we have more people that are okay with implanting and technology and where we're going with that, which is good, I guess, for Neuralink and what they are trying to achieve. So thank you very much for participating to the poll. I will go to some of the questions from the audience, the Q&A. First one who wants, some of the questions are general, so I don't necessarily want to address or pinpoint. The first one and the panelists that want to take a stab, feel free to just unmute and jump at it. So first question from Olga is, could you tell more about stimulation devices like Neuralink? So can you tell us more about stimulation in such devices like Neuralink? Is there an understanding on how to stimulate and where, how to choose neurons, protocols, etc.? So in terms of stimulation devices, yeah, John, you were muted.
Yeah, it depends on what you want to do. And the answer basically is mostly no to is there an understanding? But it depends on what you want to do. It all, you know, this is a tool. And both the recording and the stimulating parts of it, you have to define, you have to say what exactly you want to do. You know, you want to restore something, you want to enhance something, you want to change something. And then that determines where you have to go and what you have to do. At this point, we don't necessarily know. And certainly in terms of interfacing with individual neurons, we really know very little, but definitely, assuming we did know more, it very much depends on what you want to do. And it's going to be a different answer for each one of your goals, where you have to go, what you have to do, it's what you expect, what successes, etc. This again is a tool and it has a lot of possible uses. And the uses will become a lot more exciting and sophisticated as we get better scientific understanding.
Xing, I would be interested in knowing your individual cortex, you know, exactly kind of like what the goal is. So do you want to take a stab at it?
Well, stimulation of the visual cortex has been around since the 60s. It's been carried out in both experimental animals and in humans. So both blind and sighted human subjects who could report the perceptions that they experienced when their visual cortex was stimulated. And just beginning with some fundamentals, when you inject a small amount of current into the brain, people have found that you excite a small volume of tissue in the vicinity of the electrode. And that stimulates any neuronal processes that happen to be running through that volume of tissue. So cells that have the axons or the cell bodies located close to the tip of the electrode will become more active. And in the visual cortex in particular, normally the neurons, for example, in the primary visual cortex are responsible for processing information in a particular region of visual space. And if you stimulate the neurons artificially with current, it's almost as though you're hijacking neurons. So what happens is that these neurons that normally interpret information from a location in the visual field become active and people see a dot of light in that same location. And right now, this technology is still very coarse. When we inject current into the brain, we're basically zapping a whole bunch of different cells, non-specifically. We don't select particular types of cells. This might be possible in the future, but generally, people find that if you inject slightly less current, you excite slightly fewer cells. So in that way, with smaller electrodes and small amounts of current, you can sort of get slightly more specific activation of cells. And who knows, people are working on techniques to stimulate neurons using optogenetics or other more futuristic techniques. And it might be possible one day to stimulate in a more specific manner, which is why I think that the future of BCIs is going to occur in many different stages. The most rudimentary types of BCIs will allow us to create coarse percepts or to interact with the brain in a very coarse manner. And assuming that technology continues to develop, we will get more and more sophisticated iterations, but there's a lot of challenges ahead.
Yeah, I certainly agree with that. I know a little bit about the visual studies, much less than you do, obviously. But I just was struck by hearing a story about one of the original cortical stimulation implants that just had, a 4x4 array. So there were 16 channels and 16 stimuli. And the idea was that people could get a crude perception, light versus dark. They might be able to distinguish a doorway. And then it turned out that this person, they asked her how this was going. Could she do such and such? And she said, well, I'm learning how to shoot baskets. And what she had figured out how to do is to move her head back and forth and scan across the field to get much more out of these 16 channels than they basically gave. And she was able to shoot baskets. So what we're going to be able to do with these things is going to be very much and maybe even more determined by the brain than the basic technology, that what we give, we have to give something that'll work, maybe even just in a very simple way, and then let this very sophisticated system do what it can do with it. And I think similar things have happened with the auditory prostheses, that the system, given even this little assistance, this little access, can do very, very fancy things.
Yeah, with stimulation, cochlear implant was a great success with hundreds of thousands of people getting this implant. And this success was partly because you stimulated the most peripheral part of the system, auditory nerve, basically. If you try to stimulate the brainstem nuclei, then it is more complicated. Simply because when you insert your electrode in a certain brain structure and then stimulate, and this is a very crude way to deliver information, because this is a very fine structure with all the incoming fibers, etc. So this is like sticking a nail in the brain and trying to do something. But also when you stimulate mostly fibers. So let's say you stimulate visual cortex or motor cortex. So what happens, you stimulate fibers that go to the other areas, and then these areas try to make sense of these inputs that they receive. So this is a little bit different from a traditional description, like you stimulate precisely an area in this target zone, and then this zone does what it normally does. But what actually happens is that this area generates some inputs to a large amount of other areas, and then they try to interpret this. So with the stimulation, let's say, to achieve tactile sense, it is even worse, technically, because you stimulate some sensory cortex, then it goes to the spinal cord, and then eventually you get muscle contraction, something move in the periphery, and the subject may simply feel the stimulation, like the response, instead of your goal of stimulating the primary somatosensory cortex. But in any way, with the progress in the way as we stimulate, so I think there will be more and more achievements, and sensory interfaces will be very successful. Initially even more successful than these interfaces that try to decode thoughts from our brain activity.
I would definitely agree with that. In term, just going back to Jonathan's point on the number of channels, for example, you talked about 4x4. One of the Neuralink's biggest claim is the number of channels. So Elon Musk have repeatedly said that they do have like thousands, and they've shown different numbers depending on since 2019. But let's say they've mentioned 1,000 channels, which is 100 times bigger than, and then Elon Musk is stated of saying the next big thing, the competition or the other things, and then talking about the Utah array. So what, just to give people a sense of the current state of the art number of channels and why it matters, higher number of channel accounts. So what's the current state of the art number of channels, and what does it mean to have, for example, 100 more time channels?
Yeah, it matters during the first week of the recordings, and then it doesn't matter at all because most of the electrodes get encapsulated, and then they run into the problems that everybody in this field has, so that recording quality deteriorates. And like you mentioned, YouTube probe, and there are studies showing that it gets partially, completely encapsulated and even pushed out of the brains. So when you read these reports about human studies, notice that they very rarely report good neurons recorded. So typically, it is thresholding of some kind of activity, multi-units, I don't know what it is. The bottom line is that the idea of many channels is good theoretically. So if you can record millions of neurons, yeah, great, you can use this information. But practically, there is a huge problem of biocompatibility, which hasn't been solved yet.
Yeah, well, I mean, yes, that's very, very true that the beam plants that have been done, you go on months after years and you get very few neurons that you're recording for a long time. At the same time, in all fairness, the fact that they're using very thin implants they're using may work better. I'm really hopeful that people will use the cell biology more aggressively to develop methods that are different from putting in the same materials and making them thinner. But in any case, it remains to be seen how well their very thin implants will work. But thinking in terms of the channels, it really depends on what you want to do. What's your goal here? And also, there is a view that, you know, people sort of assume that looking at, or many people assume that the neurons are kind of the basic level, and everything else is derived from that. That's not necessarily the case. You know, there are many more glial cells than neurons in many areas of the central nervous system, and they participate in function as well. You know, the vessels participate. There are other structures that participate. Synaptic activity is important, even perhaps when it isn't generating action potentials. It isn't clear that this is the best way to look, or, you know, it may be important, but how much you need, whether you want to look at the level of individual neurons or you want to look at the level of the fields that reflect the activity of a bunch of neurons, remains to be seen. And it all relates, of course, to what your objective is, what you're trying to do with it. These are practical questions. They don't necessarily, they're not given out by the basic science. You know, you take the basic science and then you try to address practical issues. And that's where the answers will come. But there are multiple technical issues as well. I mean, as Mikhail was saying, that, you know, neurons don't last, but the fields do. And people are finding that that if you record local field potentials, those can be more lasting. And that's why recording from the cortical surface, or ECOG, electrocorticography, is potentially very, I mean, I'm very high on that, and at least in the immediate and medium term, that it's going to be more stable and it can be quite sophisticated and have quite high topographical as well as temporal resolution. These are all very practical issues, but just saying, oh, we have 100,000 channels, it doesn't necessarily mean it's better than 100 times better than 1,000 channels. It may be, but it depends on what you're doing, what you're trying to do with it, and what these signals are that you're actually recording.
Yeah, just following up on that, I can give a concrete example in the field of visual cortical prostheses, where people have, for example, implanted up to a few hundred electrodes in visual cortex, and the patients report being able, for example, to differentiate a cup from a bowl on the table, or to be able to see the sidewalk versus the road or the roof of their neighbor's house. And there've also been a bunch of simulation studies carried out with different numbers of pixels, so basically different numbers of electrodes, going from just a few dozen to hundreds or even thousands. And generally, people seem to find that for object recognition, you would ideally have at least dozens to hundreds, and then for much finer tasks that demand much finer visual acuity, like reading, you probably need more electrodes. And then again, there's a lot of different factors involved, because it's not only the number of electrodes, it's also the distribution of the electrodes, whether they interface with the appropriate areas of the brain, and the density of the interfacing. And all these factors interact. So channel counts, definitely people think that that would yield high resolution. But then, of course, like Jonathan said, the question is, what's the minimum resolution that's necessary for a patient to really achieve increase in quality of life?
We touched on a very important point that was one of the questions of the public about biocompatibility. So how complicated is that problem? Is that an ongoing fight that we will never end, that we'll never win, or at some point in the near future, we will master the biocompatibility? So we've mastered in different area, quote unquote, for example, like metal screws, things like that we can put in the body, and it were pretty successful in handling the biocompatibility. What about the brain? How complicated is that problem? Where are we, and is there in the near future where we feel like we'll solve that problem?
Well, it's pretty complicated, but I mean, we've advanced, but basically we haven't advanced that much. We're just getting, you know, I mean, the Romans were putting metal implants, not in the brain, but they had metal implants that lasted. And essentially, we're still putting really beds of nails into the brain. They're finer and finer, and they're better and better machined, and there are more and more of them. But that's basically what we're doing. And even what Elon Musk is doing is kind of the same thing. And there have to be better cell biological methods to interface much more intimately and much more seamlessly with the brain. Those need to be developed, and that's cell biology. But there's no reason why it can't be developed. The brain is a very unique environment biologically, and obviously very delicate, et cetera. But there's no reason why these problems can't be solved. They're scientific problems like other scientific problems that we've solved. It just needs to be done. There's a lot of work to be done in those areas. And at this point, to some extent, you can view making fancier and fancier metal arrays and finer machined is kind of like it's a side path that isn't necessarily the best path forward. We may get some initial benefits, but the ultimate improvements have to come really with more basic scientific enterprise efforts to really understand the biology and to basically meet the brain much more on its own terms, the brain tissue. But things like, I mean, like neural dust that I know Jose Camina is involved with developing, those kinds of efforts are very interesting. And this is a scientific issue. It's a very difficult one, but it can be solved.
I think that in many ways, Neuralink, given that it's such a young company, it's hit the nail on the head in some of its early hires in terms of the scientists, for example, coming out of UCSF, because there has been a lot of recent development in the field of neuroscience to create more biocompatible probes. And so just the flexibility and the sheer thinness of the probes, there has been some results that have been published that look at the amount of gliosis, for example, around these very thin probes, or the amount of damage to the neurons. So after implanting the probes in rodents for, let's say, half a year or so, you can do histology on the brain and do staining and check to see the density of cells that are in the tissue surrounding the probe. The more intact cells, the better. Or you can look at markers of the immune system response and check the amount of gliosis and tissue reaction in the vicinity of the probe. And I think that there's a lot of promise there. There's definitely some studies that show very little tissue reaction even after many months. However, it's still early days. I haven't seen any histological results from Neuralink's experiments, whether in rodents or in pigs. And I think the critical test is in a few years after implantation, are they going to see very minimal tissue reactions, or are they still going to get a lot of problems? And it's a matter of time. These are tests that we can't just perform with accelerated aging tests. We have to actually do them in animals.
Interesting. It's currently the time limit we have for the panel. However, we still have a few questions. So I would ask the panelists, are you still available if we extend for another 5-10 minutes to then wrap up last poll? And then I want to be respectful of your time, but we still have obviously this subject gather a lot of interest. So are you okay if we extend it a little bit, or we have a hard deadline?
Sure. Let's keep going.
Yeah. You have some time.
Awesome. Thanks. So the organizer, the panelist, everybody is okay with a few more minutes. Awesome. Mikhail, you mentioned about the animals. You talk about the pigs, monkeys. I want to explore just very quickly. One of the questions was, are the rats suitable for BCI experiments? So that was one question from the audience. Roslyn Talim. Moline, yeah. However, I want to extend a bit of the question to just animal in general. Is there what kind of animals are we using for BCI brain-wise? And also you talk about ethics. For example, you mentioned the pigs, like think with the frontal cortex and things like that. And then I want to have maybe Karen's perspective on the animals. Are they all the same category when we think about animal experiments? Or is there something that people need to consider or people are sensible about?
Yeah, rats are very good for these experiments. They are very smart. And the other thing that they are useful in is that they are like robots. I will explain what I mean. If you insert an electrode in the rat brain, then it stimulates and then connects it to some reward of some kind, then 5 minutes and your rat understands like how to get this reward. If you try to do this in monkey and then you stimulate a monkey in some area, then the monkey just thinks and says, this is like weird. What do you mean by this? And then you need actually more time in the smarter monkey to teach, to understand some simple stimulus. So like rats in a certain way are better, particularly with this brain-to-brain interfaces. I'm actually surprised that this is not developing rapidly, because you could connect several rats with the brain-to-brain interface and then obtain some interesting results even in like social behavior of rats or something like this. So, but to make it short, any animal or human is good for a particular task. So let's say, if you want to study some decision making, some higher order cognitive function, use better animals. Of course, when these invasive implants become safe in humans, then we will learn much more about how a human thinks, basically.
Yeah, so I mean, there are multiple issues that come up with animals. There are the basic ethical issues about the principle is you're supposed to use the lowest animal that is compatible with your particular experiment, and the fewest number of them. Also, there are issues of expense and care and everything else that come up, but then also the scientific issues. So my understanding of pigs is that they're used because they're very smart, and their brains are not that different from human brains, and that you can avoid a lot of the difficulties associated with primate research, with monkey research, which is very expensive and involving, and primates are to some extent more difficult to work with. They have the sort of normal kind of nasty primate disposition that we all have, and as Mikhail was saying, they can be very recalcitrant in terms of studies, just the way we probably would be in the same setting. So there are reasons for using one animal as opposed to another. Some animals are particularly, rats are obviously considered lower animals from pigs or monkeys. There are certain advantages in spinal cord research. The anatomy is different in the spinal cord. The corticospinal tract is differently located. It's easier to preserve. It's easier to destroy. If you want to look at its to study its function, there are various issues for choosing an animal, but it's complicated.
In terms of the different animals and maybe in the visual cortex, it was mapped a lot using cat. Are we still using cat in research for that kind of experiments, or not really?
I don't know of any groups that still does it today, to answer you very quickly.
Awesome. Karen, anything in terms of the ethics when considering animal research? Obviously, it's a sensible topic. Some people are not really in favor. What's your take on the subject?
Well, I mean, to say it's a sensitive topic is an understatement. You know, it's pretty controversial. As a scientist, who work with non-human animals, we're put in a very weird position. So I've worked with non-human animal models from cells in a dish that were derived from other animals to non-human primates to humans. And, you know, really the challenge is that if you go into science because you want to alleviate it, suffering, then you know, you don't expect to then recreate that model of suffering and then try to cure it. You know, it's a very bizarre position to be put in. So it's important to understand that every scientist who works with non-human animals, many will come across this tension within their own values, just whether they believe in non-human animal research or not. It's just that is a strange proposition to put somebody in. The other thing is that the other ethical challenge that's out there is that certainly you want to find the right animal that's going to give you useful scientific information. But when you're talking about the human brain, you know, there are arguments out there who say, you know, it's actually unethical to use non-human animals because they won't actually give you useful information that really can map onto the complexity of the human brain. That's one argument out there. And I know at NIH, for instance, we've been working on thinking about not the elimination of non-human animal research. I want to be clear about that. But one of the things we've been working on is how can we devise better proxies of the human brain that are actually going to give us this useful information. And the work by Ninad Sesson, for example, is a little bit towards that. You know, the thing we mightily struggle with humans is getting good human tissue that's still active. You know, the way that we acquire it now really has severe impact on how the science can be done. And there's a lot of reasons, technical, medical, and ethical, for why we we take that technology as we do. The other challenge that we've identified with doing brain research with non-human animals is that we are always concerned as researchers about and with that are ethically minded about the suffering of the living beings that we use, right? And so we have a lot of things in place to, we use anesthesia. We actually, you know, people have developed models of mouse face grimaces to understand their level of suffering so that they can then know whether to administer anesthesia because they don't always speak or tell or yelp when something happens. But with the type of interventions that we can do with the human brain, is there a type of suffering that we might not be able to detect? And I think that's the worry. If something were suffering, would we know it and would we be able to address that? And one of the solutions that we're putting forward now is to try to develop different kinds of technical tools alongside those experiments to better understand, have measures and proxies for suffering.
Yeah, I usually say that basically I think anyone who's completely comfortable with animal research shouldn't be doing it. I mean, we're all, I think, concerned about it. And, you know, we don't feel completely comfortable with it and we think about it a lot. And it's been certainly interesting and gratifying for me to see the developments over the last 40 years in terms of the care that goes into overseeing animal research. I mean, I can see now there were things done in the 70s that would never fly, never in the 80s and even 90s that would never fly now. Things have gotten a lot more overseen, a lot more carefully thought out. The kinds of things that Karen's talking about, thinking about how you measure suffering, et cetera, those are all very much in the forefront and there are standards being developed. Obviously, they're not ideal. Obviously, they're not perfect, but they're a lot better than what used to be. And this has really paralleled the improvement in human research. There are things that were done 30, 40, certainly 50 years ago in the U.S. that are astonishing. When papers written that are really astonishing in terms of how we think about things now. So, but it is a continuing concern in terms of minimizing, et cetera, and trying to avoid suffering. But on the other hand, it's important to realize that it is essential. This idea that certainly it doesn't perfectly parallel what happens in humans. Even the monkey brain doesn't perfectly parallel the human brain, but it's very useful and very, we learn a lot. For many years I carried around in my wallet a picture of children in iron lungs. This was in the 50s and 60s, because when I was in medical school, there were still some of those old devices lying around from polio every summer. You know, that doesn't happen anymore. And that's because of animal research. And that is still essential. In terms of the brain, we understand really very little about how the brain functions. Sure, we can do some things in computer models. We do some in our lab, but it's minimal. It's limited. It's ancillary. There's no real substitute at this point or in the foreseeable future for doing actual studies in humans as well as in animals. So we need to try to reduce animal research as much as possible, but if we're gonna advance things, if we're gonna alleviate suffering and disease and the results of trauma, animal research is essential and will be for the foreseeable future.
There was recently an entire issue of PNAS devoted to primate research, and then they just explain item by item where this research is needed, and it is very convincing. Also, brain-computer interfaces will enter animals soon, I think, because animals will need them as well. Because they also suffer from problems, like dogs may have spinal cord injuries, so they will need cure. So I think this is coming as well.
Is there time for me to add something quickly?
Yep, go.
Yeah, like Jonathan pointed out, I think we need to look at the bigger picture and what are all the reasons for wanting to do these experiments and what we can potentially stand to achieve in terms of alleviating disease and suffering. And a very high profile example that I read about in the news recently was that the monoclonal antibody drug that President Trump received after he was diagnosed with COVID was actually tested on one, golden hamsters, and second, monkeys. And so I think it's good for people to realize where these drugs come from, where the vaccines come from. And if you think that it's possible to just stop all research and not make any progress, well then, you know, you'll just have COVID rampaging on throughout the world.
It also was tested in human fetal cells too, right? So, I mean, and as well as animals. So it also speaks for that kind of research too.
Awesome. That we could talk about this and we could go deeper, and I've had some requests as well talking about so Brendan just mentioned in the chat about dogs. Some people have asked about birds because we know that crows, ravens are pretty smart. So can we do are there experiments with that? So we can definitely go in and spend a lot of time, and we haven't even touched a lot of the tech side of things, the question, the power, the connector, all these things, the perception of the public as well. So we could talk about it. The good thing is that it's an ongoing discussion that we will continue talking about that for the years to come. So we don't have to solve everything today. We can keep for a bit more for tomorrow. So I want to thank very much all the speakers for the panels, for this amazing panel. I personally had a blast. I want to leave the audience with one more poll. So if we can bring the question, obviously one thing that went viral with Elon Musk is that idea of mind-to-mind communication or telepathy, where we won't have to talk or type. Facebook announced something like that as well with their BCI program, 100 words a minute. So let's just go with a simple question. Do you think we will ever achieve mind-to-mind communication, at least with the same richness or level of details that we do with language right now? Yes or no way. So obviously, there is no right or wrong answer here. It's purely subjective. I don't know that anybody can really have a hard yes or a hard no, but interested in having your opinion and to know if you're, if Neuralink should target you as a future consumer of their devices for telepathic communication. And once again, while the polls and the answers are coming in, I want to thank very much. We had an amazing discussion. You guys made my life really, really easy of just answering and going on all the questions and providing a lot of insights. So I'm very, very grateful for this this opportunity. I hope that we'll have the opportunity to have another one in the future, including other Facebook, Open Water. There are so many more companies that are making the headlines and others that should be making the headlines as well that are not necessarily making headlines. So it would be interesting to talk about these as well. So the poll 55-45, so it's a bit more in the middle than the last one. So definitely interesting. We'll see when we ask that question again in 3 years from now, if we start seeing a trend in one way or another. But for today, that's it for me. What I would recommend people to do next in the conference is the exhibitions. So if you haven't seen the virtual island just yet, I definitely encourage you to go visit it. There are booths, there are exhibitions with different companies, there are posters. So please go walk by on the island. It's awesome. It's the new conferencing COVID style, where we go and we have virtual interaction with conference. The organizers did an amazing job in creating this island with different booths. So please go navigate, interact with people. You can have one-on-one whereby chats, a little bit like Zoom right now, but on a whereby platform. So you can just enter the call. We'll have the person from the booth attending as you would do walking by a booth at a usual conference. So I'll hand over back to the organizer, unless anyone from the panel has a last word, remark, things to mention on my side, that's a wrap for me.
I just wanted to say thank you, and I look forward to an in-person drink at the Neuro Bar next time.
Yes, thank you very much. It's been a lot of fun, Julie.
Yeah, thanks.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. So I'll head over to Alexei, and a quick reminder of the Neuro Bar: in about 2 hours from now, there will be a Neuro Bar. So if you're interested in joining us, there will be more of the conversation of what we just discussed this morning in about 2 hours from now at the Neuro Bar. So I'll let the organizer take over from here. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Yannick. Thank you, all panelists. And let me give Yannick